Okay, I'm going to talk a little bit about Mosin Receivers, the steel, the fit and finish, this kind of stuff. So it comes about from that guy's comments about 913s were unsafe because of the time period they were built in. And I've got 8 Mosins here, different time periods, and we'll look at them in a minute here, look at the fit and finish, the receivers, and we'll talk a little about the steel, the different time periods, how I understand they made the receivers, kind of steel they used. These guns were built pretty much the same as any other country at the time. Like, pretty much the only way they were building guns in those days was like forging billets of steel. They smashed them with these big trip hammers, bashed the steel, and that drove like the impurities out of it. And I guess the Russians just used like carbon steel. They didn't have any kind of crazy alloys or exotic alloys. So you bash the thing, I guess, till it sort of approximates the shape of the receiver. Then you mill it out, and you use carbon steel because it's easy to machine. And then you heat treat the thing after you got it machined out, and that more or less gives you kind of a hard surface, soft internal. So then it's, I guess, like the hard outside kind of resists wear, surface wear, and sort of like surface peening. But then the internal part is soft, so that it's not brittle and it won't like fracture or crack, which can happen if it's heat treated improperly. I guess if you heat treat it too much or heat treatment is too deep, it kind of happened with like some of the Springfield rifles, some of the P-14s, 1917s and stuff like this. It happened to them. They burnt the metal or overheated it and it became sort of like cast iron. Which with the Mosin, it's like, or actually most of those guns too, it never really showed up until people started dicking with them and taking barrels off and putting fucking magnums and stuff on them. The Mosin is kind of in the same boat. It's sort of so heavily built that with service ammo, you'd probably never ever like find out that the thing was too hard or too soft. There is pictures on the internet of a guy has like a 1932 9130 that the receiver cracked off, or barrel and the receiver kind of screwed it, or where they meet inside, and it shows like quite excessive, sort of looks like cast iron or quite crystallized inside. So either the gun was overheated or damaged in some way before it was like refurbed or whatever, they just never noticed, and or it's just some guy that didn't know what he was doing on that day at the factory. Like, that's the thing with heat treatment, the guy that knows what he's doing, they do a real nice job. People that don't know what the fuck they're doing, like newbies, then you can get guns that are kind of fucked up. But it's everybody that's ever built guns, they've always had bad ones. Just with most guns, like a softer receiver is normally, it's not better, but it's sort of like you can get away with more if it's too soft, and if it's too hard, you get in problems with it cracking and shit like this. But if it's too soft, then it's just sort of, it peens itself. You can kind of look at examples of like some of the Spanish built like 93s, 98s and stuff. Locking lugs would beat their way back and they'd get locking lug setback and stuff because of sort of hit or miss heat treatment. Like a good one is good, like, but a soft one, it's still, it works. It's just, you can get head space and the gun's not going to fucking fracture and explode. It's just, I guess eventually you get head space and then you can have, you can have head separations and shit like that, but softer. Like with a Mosin, a little bit hard probably wouldn't hurt it because the way it's built. A little bit soft probably wouldn't really hurt it either. But and some of these guns are really, really freaking old, and there's quite a few of them in use still. And there's, you don't hear about them failing like left, right, and center. Like, but it's but I guess there is time periods where there's sort of like a higher percentage of possibility of having a hard, like a hard receiver or soft receiver, but you just don't hear about them blowing up or failing well. Like, it's just, so a lot like most of these stories about people saying they're not good is just people that don't like Mosins for some weird reason. I don't know. But some people just get hate on for different kinds of guns. It's kind of like the Annie Carcano club or whatever. They just don't like Carcanos. I think they're inaccurate and they're junky and they're going to blow up. And Carcanos are some of the, you know, not the strongest gun in the world, but they're not weak. Like, there's been people done tests on them and they had trouble blowing them up. So they're just... But anyway, probably your best built Mosin receivers would be like pre-World War One. That's when they were taking a lot of time. They put like 40,000 proof marks on those older guns. They checked them out quite a bit. World War One, they rushed them a bit, but I guess they were still proofing them quite well. I guess your sort of your not the best put together ones would be in your Civil War time period, which would be, I guess, 1917, 18, until 1923 or around there. Because the communists had a really bad habit of shooting people that knew what they were doing. They'd go into a factory and shoot all the guys that ran the place because they were the hell the communists called them. But anyway, people the communists didn't like anyway. The intelligentsia or the fuck they called them. Anyway, and then they moved peasants in there to run the place, and they didn't know anything. So I guess that's sort of a bad time period, but I don't know. There's quite a few 1920s dated receivers floating around. They're still going, so it's, I don't know. And then another time period, like mid to late 20s into the 30s, before the Second World War. People say that Stalin and his five-year plans or something, they were rushing production and cutting corners, but I don't believe that. I think his five-year plans were just to up steel production and things. And if things got fucked up, heads would roll. Like, Stalin didn't put up with people failing, so you better build them fast, but you better build them good at the same time. So, and then your World War II built stuff, which is really disgusting looking machining, but I don't think the steel actually degraded any. Some people say that their steel got worse, but I don't know where they're getting their information from. But you might get into problems with undertrained employees that didn't heat treat the gun properly or whatever. But it's all like, nobody ever has anything to back up any of their stories. Like, oh, all the Russians, they built the guns during the Second War out of slag metal or monkey metal. But nobody ever has any proof that shows anything different, that they're just making out of the same steel they always had. Like, come to the same steel plant, they were probably upping production. They upped production by having like 24-hour shifts. Like, they were just working constantly. Instead of people going home at 5, they stayed there till 12 hours or whatever, you know, kind of deal. So it's, you know, it's nice to up production, but you don't cut corners where the gun's going to explode when you shoot it. Like, that doesn't get you any further ahead. Like, you can cut corners on machining. The gun looks like hell, but it's still strong. It's like, the Russians were smart enough to understand that. Like, the people that ran Russia weren't morons. Or not most of them, anyway. But they understood that you can cut corners in certain areas that don't matter. Like, the cosmetics of the gun. As long as it still has, you know, the action should be smooth. Like, the inside of the receiver, you machine that. Because if you don't, it's going to be goddamn useless, so... You're going to spend time on that. You're going to spend time on making it out of half-decent steel. And if you fucked up, as I said before, Stalin would be sending your ass to the gulag, or you'd be in a penal battalion somewhere getting shot. So, anyway, that's how I understand the steel, the time periods, and that kind of stuff. But we'll go over some of these guns here. I have guns that date from 1896 up here down to 1943 down here. They're all Russian-built receivers, and now cut this off, and I'll splice in. I'll show you all the different 8 guns I have here, and I show you the sort of the fit and finish of the receivers, and kind of show you the ups and downs of Russian production. Okay, we'll show you the different what the receivers look like, fit and finish of them. Just cleared out this space here so they kind of see what see a little better here. All right. So this one here, it's an M24 finish, but it's got a 1896 Astraeus receiver on it. You can see here it has some peening, so it's not terribly hard. It's well machined, nice and smooth. This is well put together. There's no machine marks anywhere. So that's probably your high water mark for production, probably somewhere around that time period. This next one here, it's 1915 Tula. You can see here, war years, they were kind of, see the surface is, looks like it's scratched, like it's rough. You can see she's not terribly hard, she's probably heat treated probably. You can see where the cotton piece was hitting it and peening it. And where they, I guess they put that punch there to try to keep the screw from backing out probably. Now she's dimensionally good, it's just a little bit rough, but they needed guns in the first war. They're losing them at a pretty crazy rate. Okay. This one here is, she's Tula M91, which is built in 1922. You can see here, this would be like Russian Civil War. And she's sort of the same par as the World War I machining quality. It appears here that the barrel is not really put in, or it's a bit thinner on top here. But she's a bit rough. But the Finns did capture it and use it, so they thought enough of it to reuse it. So, but this would be apparently a bad time period. Here is a 1925. I guess it has Izvesk. I hear wreath and stuff on there. This would be just after the Civil War, just after Stalin took over. So they did, you know, the machining did come back a bit. There's no real rough machining on it or anything. Pretty well done. This gun's probably still on it. I've seen a few shots, so it's probably good. And you got 1934 Tula. You see, they're quite well machined and everything. Finish is quite nice and inside and everything. And you can see it's peened up a bit, so it doesn't seem to be overly hard or anything. So she probably treat it properly. And then we got 1937 Tula. And there's a round receiver. I forget if they changed in 36 or 35, but got their. There's no real, I guess, quality difference between like the round ones and the hex ones of this time period, like in the late 30s. They're quite nice and smooth, well put together. And this is the finish capture as well, so they, I think the Finns used to kind of check them a little bit when they got them. They'd see if they were, what the heat treatment was like on them. Then you got the wonderful world of wartime production. This one, the 42, is a Jesk. She's pretty horrid. But there's, I guess the Finns were checking things with hitting them with punch marks. And you can see here they hit it right there apparently to see if she was too hard or not. But 42 might be the year that you would might have some bad heat treatment, people not knowing what they were doing, but she's pretty rough, but they still work well anyway. And this one here is a 1943 Jess, or Esvest, or fuck. It's still pretty rough. And rough and everything there, but I don't know. Overall, I haven't really seen any evidence that Mosins are bad or anything. So anyway, drop your comments, guys. And what do you guys think? But it's just, you know, if you build 30 million rifles and have a couple that are heat treated improperly and they crack or something, that's pretty damn good, I think.